I've, through the development of the GBT, and also has worked with Breakthrough Listen, with many of the other instruments on site, the 140-foot, etc. And so you have a very interactive talk with Ron. So get out your pencils or your notepads or whatever you'd like, because there will be quizzes throughout. Take it away, Ron.
Well, good morning, everyone. So Steve told you what, there's a lot of lingo in radio astronomy, sorry to say. And what he was describing was what we call front ends. And then Ryan Lynch later on, even today, I think he's going to be talking about the back end. And I will be describing the components between the front end, which is the receiver, and the back end, which is your detector. Okay. As Will pointed out, there's actually going to be quizzes during this lecture. Those remotely, you're going to have to use the online presentation to actually get to the quizzes. So when we get to that point, you'll see what I'm talking about. Questions throughout, don't worry, just raise your hand. Same thing from the remote people, just ask a question and Bren will raise her hand and we will try to get to them when you ask them. Okay, all right. So Steve presented some of the schematics for receivers, and I'm just going to do a sort of a generic sort of GBT like schematic throughout this whole thing. It's not the GBT, but it's almost the GBT. And so in a schematic, you read from left to right. And so here's the feed of the receiver, some components we'll talk about, and then when it goes. All right.
Here's a new one.
I have no idea what happened. All right. And where's the stick?
It's right behind you.
There it is.
On the pad.
On the
other side of the computer.
Gotcha. All right. And so you read from left to right. So you get to the right side, hand side of the page, and then you can continue from left to right, and so on and so on. So, so we're going to go through each one of these components and talk about what they do. Okay. So these are the typical components in schematics. And a lot of the devices are named exactly like what they do, like an amplifier. An amplifier takes this input signal, and the output signal is of higher power than the input signal. Okay. Well, we're going to be talking a lot about mixers. An attenuator just does the opposite. The input signal is higher than the output signal. And some attenuators, you can actually change the amount of the attenuation. Your power detectors in radio telescopes, there is power coming down the wire, a small fraction of it is sent to a power detector. So you can see at some place along that stream of signal where what the actual power is at that point. Synthesizers work with mixers. We'll talk about those in a bit. Splitters do exactly what they say. An input signal is split, in this particular case, four waves. Couplers do the opposite of a power detector in that there's an input signal and an output signal, and something comes in. And at this point, it is the sum of whatever is coming here and the sum of what's coming from that device there. So it adds two signals from two devices together. We'll be talking a bit about filters, switches, and a multiplier means that a frequency coming in this particular case, it says times four. If you put in 1 gigahertz here, 4 gigahertz comes out the other end. Okay. So we're going to go through some of the more esoteric. Pointers always work. There we go. All right, so there are four types of filters used in radio telescopes. A bandpass filter, so in each one of these diagrams, frequencies is along the x-axis, and the gain or attenuation through the filter is along the y-axis. A bandpass filter is one which only passes frequencies between that and that. All other frequencies are attenuated. A low-pass filter is a filter which attenuates all frequencies above a certain frequency, so anything lower than the cutoff frequency is passed. High-pass filter is the opposite. You have a frequency below which nothing passes, but above which everything passes. And then you have a notch filter, which is the sort of the inverse of a bandpass filter, in that everything passes except a small range in frequency. And basically, you build bandpass filters and notch filters out of combining a low pass and a high pass filter. Now, I'm an astronomer, as Will said. So, in many of the things that I'm talking about, I don't know how the electronics does it. I really, as an astronomer, don't care. What I really care about is what it does. Yeah.
Do you employ digital filters here or physical filters?
Excuse me?
Do you employ digital filters like after the signal goes to recorder, or do you have physical filters?
Digital filters.
Oh, sorry. Okay. So we have a combination of digital and analog filters. So I'll be talking mostly about analog filters. Okay. But basically, in digital, you could do the same sort of. You could do all of this in digital filters as well if you were able to. Once you sample. Okay. Now, mixers are the more complicated components in a radio telescope. What you have is sort of like when you learn your basic physics, you learned about beating. You have two frequencies which beat. You have something at 1600 hertz and something at 1500 hertz, and what you hear out of it is not just the 1500 but the 1600, but you hear the difference between those two. So that's what mixers are essentially doing in radio telescopes. You have a frequency coming in. This is coming down from the sky or from something further up in the chain. You have a synthesizer that is producing a pure tone. That's called the local oscillator frequency. And what the mixer does is it produces the difference or the sum of these two frequencies. And so what comes out of a mixer is this equation here, where N and M are integers, and it could either be plus or minus. And in almost all mixers that we deal with, the radio astronomers, N and M are either 1 or minus 1. So we either get here the difference of frequencies or the sum of the frequencies, depending upon what N and M are. And then we have, sorry to say, some more jargon. Up conversion is if this frequency, the output frequency, is higher than the input frequency. And of course, down conversion is the opposite, if this frequency is lower than that frequency. And then we have what's called a lower sideband mixer and an upper sideband mixer. And that is if the local oscillator frequency is above or below the input frequency. Okay, it's just terms. All right, the reason we want to do this kind of work is because we want multiple receivers to use the same components in the system. And so if you have a receiver at 5 gigahertz and then one receiver at 50 gigahertz, and you want to use the same components, you want to be able to mix down or up so that the two receivers will use the same components throughout the whole system. The other reason we want to do this is that if you lower the frequency, those components are usually a lot cheaper than if you have high frequency components. There's also more losses if you are trying to send a high frequency signal down a cable. And so if you want to send a signal down a long distance, you usually want to lower your frequency so the losses are less. So there are many reasons why we do this and where we do it, but it's basically the engineers deciding what's the best way to do this so to keep the system temperatures as low as possible and to keep the components as redundant between as many receivers as possible. Okay, many different kinds of switches. Pretty much you have two inputs that you can select. You have four, you have input and you have four different outputs you can select. You have here, same here. And we also have cross switches where you have two inputs and the signal can either go straight through or you can flip the switch and then the signals cross each other. When you use a GBT, you'll be seeing these in various diagrams in the signal processing that goes on. Okay, so I'm gonna give, we'll start off talking about the 40 foot telescope. If I did this for the 20 meter, which you will be using, it'll look a lot like this. We have the feed, a polarizer, which splits the signals into two polarizations. We have two identical chains, an amplifier, bandpass filter, a mixer, a low pass filter. Then this goes through a second mixer, some more bandpass filters, and then back to a chart recorder, anything, a voltmeter. At this point, your detector, think of a detector as a voltmeter. So one of the components in here is we have this coupler, which adds a signal from a noise source, which has a switch, which can be opened or closed. And the reason for this, one of the things in radio astronomy and most astronomy is that in almost all cases, what we are doing mathematically when we're analyzing our data is using ratios and the differencing between signals. So here we have just a typical observation. You're pointing toward the object part of the time, then you point toward the blank piece of blank sky part of the time. And then while you're looking at blank sky, you turn on this noise source, this calibration source, and then turn it off again. So we have four phases, you're off source, you're on source, you're back off source, you turn on the noise source, and then you turn it back off. And so this is what such an observation would look like. You're off source, you're on source, you're off source, you turn on the noise calibrator, and then off again. The engineer tells you that the noise source has a temperature, has an equivalent antenna temperature of 3 Kelvin. Can any tell me what how the strength of the continuum source is? If this is 3 Kelvin, how much has the... Say it out loud. 6. Right. It's twice as high. Right. And so you've gone from, right. So the height here is twice the height of this. If this is 3 Kelvins, this must be 6 Kelvin. Okay. 3 Kelvin, if you look over here on the y-axis, has increased the number of counts proportional to the amount of power, the voltage coming out of the system. Of 30,000. So if 3 Kelvin equals 30,000 counts, what is 200,000 counts equal? This is your system temperature on blank sky. And the answer is 20 Kelvin. If this is 3 Kelvin, then this is, right? So all you're doing here is ratios and differencing between measurements. And that is the basis of almost all your observations you'll be making on a radio telescope. You'll always be using something as a calibration source to derive the signal strength of the actual object you're looking at. And that the noise calibrator also tells you what the intensity of your system temperature is. Again, just pure differencing, pure ratios. That's all we're doing here. Okay, so back to the 40 foot system. So here's problem number one. I should have handed these out beforehand, but take one and pass. So feel free to work. There's nothing that you do in astronomy or any science where you work alone. So feel free to work together. If you're sitting close to somebody, just work together. It's a good thing to actually, you know, strive for one another, what's going on. That's the way we learn. We're just going to do the first question, and then you guys can work on it, or on the second question in the quiz on your own. So the question is, the quiz is, if 1420 megahertz is entering the system here, I want to get it to this point at with a 30 kilohertz band pass. So that we want to have 30 kilohertz of frequency space observed, right, centered at 1420 megahertz. And the question is, what do you pick for this local oscillator frequency, the synthesizer frequency? Again, this is a device that puts out a single frequency tone. And then there's a second one as well. So you have two mixers here that you have to go through. And so the question is, what values do you have for this? And then along the path here, what are the frequencies that are going through the cables? So as a clue, you usually cannot work out the problem like starting here and going downward. Usually you have to go down as far as you can go and then work backwards. Right, so you have to work the problem in two different directions. Typically, you start off going down and then you finish up going upstream.
It's the signals that subtract the signals. You get one or two, and that's why there's the low pass. It's that top signal. It does both, but that's why you need the low pass. So the low pass is.
No, we can do that.
So we yeah, I have an official.
Raise your hand once you get it. What do you think you get?
Yes. Like also note that it's.
There are actually two answers. I'll also give you that clue.
Yes, that's what it's like.
Yeah, okay.
Like whatever is here is X plus minus.
Because this is fixed.
Exactly. So once you have this value, you go backwards.
Jen, raise your hand when you're done, or we got to the point where you want us to move on.
I can do that. Okay, so I also, I hope I'm not doing this straight. So.
One more minute. All right, pens down.
Yeah, but then the vampire.
Everyone? All right. You had your opportunities. Okay. So this is the way I work it. There we go. All right. So this is a band. So I'm going to work it backwards, actually. So this is a bandpass filter. Its center is 10.7 megahertz. It has a 30 kilohertz bandwidth, which is what we want, right? Which means that the signal coming into this bandpass filter has to be 10.7 megahertz in order for the system to work, right? So 10.7 is the input to the bandpass filter, which means it's the output of this mixer. The synthesizer is fixed at 110.7 megahertz. And so at this end, what should come in is either 100 megahertz or the sum of 110.7 and 10.7, which is what, 121.4. Okay, so if I picked 121.4, you'll see that it doesn't go through this low pass filter. So 121.4 may couldn't go, can't be the input of this low pass filter because it would never come out. So the only answer is that at this point, the signal has to be at 100 megahertz. 100 megahertz enters low pass filter. That's cool because 100 megahertz will be passed by the low pass filter. And so we have this mixer. And so you now either add or subtract 100 megahertz, the 1420.41. And so the two answers are either 1521.41 or 1320.41. Once you've done this thousands of times over a career of 40 years, you can almost do this in my head. So I haven't given this lecture in a number of years, so I actually beforehand had to go out there and solve it myself. All right. So we're going to step through each one of these devices that are on the GBT or the pseudo GBT. Are they getting on the telescope? Yes, right? So you will see this. This is the inside of the receiver room. This is the bottom of the turret and all the parts. This is what a typical schematic is for one of our receivers. This is the 1 to 2 gigahertz L band receiver, another piece of jargon for you. Again, it looks a lot like what we just saw for the 40 foot feed, polarizer splits the signals, et cetera, et cetera. And it has, you know, just a single mix. This particular case, it also has a polarization hybrid here, which allows you to use the output of the polarizer is linear polarization, and by flipping the switch, you essentially can turn the receiver into a circular receiver. That's what this thing does. And we have the same thing like the 40 foot. We have a noise source that's a calibration source that's injected just before the first amplifier. A multi-beam receiver, very similar. It just has each. If you really examine this, you'll see that all the components are almost identical to what you saw in the L-band receiver. There's just lots more of them. So we have a receiver, and then we have to have our synthesizers, which go into our mixers. We want to use the same synthesizers for all our receivers. And so basically we have synthesizers here and a huge switching matrix, which routes the synthesizer frequency to the receiver that you're using on the telescope. This isn't necessary if your radio telescope only has one receiver because you just have a direct route, but because we have multiple receivers that are up simultaneously, we have to have this kind of switching matrix, which provides a routing from the synthesizer to the mixers in the receiver. Next, we have the IF rack. There are only 16 fibers coming from the, so we take the signal from the telescope, we put it on analog fibers, and then we send that analog fibers to the control room and the receiver room right above us. But there are only 16 fibers. We now have to route a signal from multiple receivers onto those 16 fibers. And that's the job of what we call the IF rack, where it's, again, it's just a switching matrix that provides a way of saying what receivers are going to send what signals down what fiber. Right. So in this particular case, the prime focus receiver is sending a signal down the fiber. One of the things that you'll see in the system are attenuators. Let's see, where's our attenuator? Here's our attenuator, okay? And it has, and you're allowed to set the value of the attenuator. One of the things we wanna make sure is that you don't feed the power to subsequent electronics beyond the usable range of those electronics. So you wanna keep the system linear. What linear means is essentially that the power in is proportional to the power out. And the slope here is essentially the attenuation or the amplification at that component. If your system is nonlinear, then your power in and your power out might have this strange shape. And what you want to do is you want to make sure that the power is in this linear range. And so you have to set attenuators through the system. It's a term we call on the GBT of balancing. where the power level is set so that you're in the center of that linear region in the gain curve of all these components. Too much power, you get gain compression and saturation. Too little power, and you're not, and the device doesn't react as it should. So linearity is an important component, and setting your attenuators properly maintains linearity. Next thing is we want to be able to send the signal to multiple backends, and that's the job of the converter module. It basically, different backends, different detectors have different ranges of frequency over which they operate. And so you have mixers and synthesizers in the converter module, which again, converts the signal from this. All these components are generic for all our receivers. And basically you pick these frequencies so that your generic signal can be processed to the backend detector that you're actually using for your experiment. So that's the job of these down here. Prepare the signal for the input frequencies of your detector. And you'll see this when you get up and then you get a tour of the control room. Then you'll see all these components upstairs. Again, with fibers you're looking at, and then you have mixers, and then you have paths to the different backends. So you have the flip switches, set synthesizers, all that sort of stuff. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. Okay. And we'll skip on that. Quiz number two is going to be a little bit more complicated. And we're only going to do this for about 5 minutes, and then we're going to move on. Okay. But basically, what we want you to do is, again, 1420 megahertz is in. We want you to be able to specify the values for these red components. These components and each one of those components has a sort of a range of values that you can actually specify. You want a 1420 megahertz signal to have a bandwidth at the back end at the detector of 50 megahertz. That's not the center frequency, that is the bandwidth. Again, the only way you're going to work this is you're going to be able to go down so far, and then you're going to have to work up the rest of the, for the rest of the values. Giving up working together. All right, put pens down. So one of the things, this is the important, one of the more important numbers. You want to band, all the band pass filters have to be at least 50 megahertz wide, right? So that's an important clue. So let's go through this. All right, so you have 1420 in, and we have four different choices for band pass filter one. Three of them work, one of them doesn't. Right, because 14, if you have this bandpass filter, this last one wouldn't work because that's doesn't pass 1420 megahertz. Now, from a practicality point of view, what you want to do is pick. So any one of these filters, if you chose any one of those three filters, you have the right answer. From a practical standpoint, you want the filter that's narrowest so that if there is RFI coming in, you would attenuate it out. And so the narrower the filter you use, the less RFI you will have going down the rest of the system. We have this amplifier after the mixer, which goes from 2600 to 3400. And so its center is 3000. So you have 1420 coming in, 3000 coming out. And so it's either the sum or the difference between those two. And as I said in the description of the problem, this is a lower sideband mixer. And so the synthesizer is at a higher frequency. And so you take those two numbers, add them together, you get 4420. So 4420 mixes with 1420, produces 3 gigahertz. And now you have a choice for bandpass filter two. There are bandpass filter two has, some of them have a center of 6 gigahertz. And 6 gigahertz, of course, will not pass 3 gigahertz. And so all the ones that have a 6 gigahertz center frequency don't work. And now you have four that are centered at 3 gigahertz. Three of them work, the fourth one doesn't, because this filter only has a bandwidth of 20 megahertz. We want a bandpass filter that passes at least 50 megahertz. So yeah, of the three that remain, again, for the reason you want to exclude RFI as much as possible, you would probably, for practical reasons, pick the first one. So 3 gigahertz goes off the right side of the page. 3 gigahertz enters. So this is now on the fiber. The fiber comes to this room, up the room above us, turn back into an analog wave. And then we have to talk about these components here. And it's not possible to go from here down. You have to start going from the back end up. We want 50 megahertz as our bandwidth. And so we have two choices for bandpass filter three. You have one that goes from 50 to 100 megahertz, but the other one is only 12 and a half megahertz wide. We want one that's 50 megahertz wide, so that one's not good. So that is the bandpass filter we want, which means its center is 75 megahertz. So 75 megahertz is the output of this filter. So this synthesizer is at 500. So the input is either at 425 or 575. But because it's low pass filter, 575 wouldn't pass through it. So at this point, the signal has to be at 425 megahertz. So you have 425 megahertz here. This is another fixed synthesizer. So it's either 10,075 megahertz or 10,925 megahertz. Those are your two choices. But that latter choice doesn't go through this bandpass filter. And so the frequency has to be 10,075 megahertz. And then that has to mix with this. And again, these are all lower sideband mixers. So this frequency has to be above this one. And so you have to sum those two. And so the frequency of this synthesizer is 13,075 megahertz. Okay. Got it? Any questions? Right. It's just practice, practice, practice. That's the only thing that this requires. Just do this often enough and it becomes second nature. So the GPT is a complicated system. Each one of these large rectangle is a box of some shape or other. This does not describe what happens in the box, but this is the path signal takes to get from the front end to the back end. So there are many switches, many synthesizers, many things that have to be set in the GBT to route a signal properly from the front end, the receiver, to the back end. All the synthesizer settings have to be right, all the frequencies have to be set in the synthesizers, all the bandpass filters, all the switches, everything has to be done properly. And when we started out with the GBT 20 odd years ago, all of that had to be done by hand. All right, what you just did is what we did before every observation started. We were given half an hour before every project started just to get all this stuff right. Right? But then we said, you know, why don't we write a piece of software? And that's what we do right now. The GBT, what you do is you specify what receiver you want, what back end you want, what frequencies you want, what bandwidth you want, and it does the routing for you. So you don't have to do this, you don't have to do this calculation, but for those using other radio telescopes, if Arecibo were still alive, you'd be handed a bunch of patch boards and you would have to patch things together to produce that routing. So you would have to know at certain telescopes how to do this by hand, right? The GBT has a lot more computer software. All the switches, all the filters are hooked up to software that flips the switches, sets the filters for you. Many radio telescopes don't have that kind of sophistication. You have to do it by hand. But again, this makes it nice and simple for GBT observers. And now this all happens in a matter of seconds, and we don't need the half hour at the beginning of every observing session to set things up properly. Okay. And the only way we learn how to write this piece of software is by all those years of doing this calculation. We realized there were patterns in what we were, with the calculations we were doing. And therefore, once we found out that we had patterns that we were using over and over again, we could then say, okay, software folks, write us a piece of software that follows that pattern. That's it.
Ron, what questions do we have?
So one of the details I don't think it's been emphasized enough is that radio astronomy is different than optical astronomy in that in optical astronomy, you use a photographic plate, a CCD or something like that. As soon as the photon hits that CCD, you lose all the phase information. There's no longer, you're counting photons, you're no longer have an electromagnetic wave. In radio astronomy, until you hit the detector in the back end, you have an electromagnetic wave. So there's lots of, there's a whole sets of components in radio astronomy that aren't used in other wave bands because you can retain the frequency and phase information all the way down to our detector. So for example, if you want linear or circular polarization, since you contain the phase information, you can at the back end do full Stokes. While optical astronomers, you cannot do full Stokes at the with the same observing setup. You have to put circular or linear polarizers in front of your detector, in front of your system, in order to do full Stokes. And you have to switch those between them, between linear filters and circular filters to get the full Stokes of your observation. So this is an important detail that I think we have to emphasize enough. This is why we can do interferometry so simply in radio astronomy versus at other wavelengths. No questions? How does it actually work? What is actually inside a mixer? Good question. I don't know. it really is essentially the beating of two frequencies. So you can talk to the books on this stuff, but I'm not gonna spout something that's outside my field of expertise. So I don't know what actually happens inside of a mixer. It's a nonlinear device. So for some reason, you put two frequencies in and outcomes the difference with the sum.
So what would be the average or median setup time for most observations now?
Oh, with this piece of software?
Yes.
Seconds. Literally seconds. Because it flips switches and synthesizers simultaneously. The only step that takes a little bit of time is this balancing step. And that might take 20 seconds.
Okay. That's at the beginning of each.
And that's usually at the beginning of every observing session. There are lots of things you should do at the beginning of every observing session. One is configure, one is to set the balance points. And the other thing is to look at a test source to make sure that everything is set right.
Good question on what? After the IF rack, why include additional converter modules and analog filters? Can the initial LO and the bandpass filter be set to give one the desired output?
Okay. So when the GPT was being designed in 30 years ago, the thought was that we would pass over the fiber an analog signal, not digitized. So if we were to redesign the GPT today, we would probably digitize the signal at the IF rack, not at the back, and not have to send that digitized signal over fiber, not an analog signal. So it would really have removed all of the converter rack components, all those extra mixers. Back in 1994, when we were designing the system, the samplers were not fast enough to do high frequency sampling. And so the bandwidth of samplers wasn't very wide. And so that's why we did this analog system as well. So there are a couple of reasons why. And again, if we were to design this all over again, we probably would do something quite different.
Do you do recommend replacing the optical fiber and do the analog digital conversion first?
Yeah.
Will that decrease the interference that you got here, or
Oh, the thing is, it might reduce versatility because of one of the things we can do in the equipment room upstairs is we can split the signal and then do, for example, if you're doing something at with our high frequency receivers. Right now, we can observe at, let's say, 95 and 85 gigahertz simultaneously, right? And to have a digitizer at in the receiver room that could do over 10 gigahertz of bandwidth isn't practical yet. Those are really, if they exist, are going to be really, really expensive. So by doing this conversion in the equipment room, we can use cheaper components and have a little bit more versatility in how many spectral lines we can observe simultaneously and the frequency difference between the spectral lines. So we would probably redesign it differently if we did it today, but we may have to compromise what we can do today a little bit.
Maybe I heard you wrong, but when you said that the analog over optical signal is received in the control room, that you had to reconstruct the signal?
Yeah, we completely reconstruct the signal.
So, I don't know, to me that means you're quantizing it in front of the analog.
No, it is basically the laser is oscillating and proportional to right. The output of the optical fiber is exactly the represents the analog signal going into it. It is an analog signal. There's no digitization at all happening before the fiber.
And what reconstruction happens on the receive side then? If it's the
there's an optical transmitter in the IF rack and an optical receiver in the converter rack. And okay, so what comes out of the optical receiver is identical to what went into the optical.
The signaling media conversion going from optics to electrical then.
It's going from an electrical signal down a cable to a light signal going over fiber back to that same electrical signal that went into the optical.
Okay, so that's going to be very interesting. All right.
Yeah, it's old fashioned, but yeah, still works. Anything else? It's lunchtime, isn't it? Okay, good for you.
Going once, going twice. Thank you very much.